Which is the closest planet to Earth?
Mars.
Not Mars. Anybody else?
Venus.
Oh,
the moon?
No, just generally.
Mercury.
Yes, absolutely right. It is Mercury. But it's not how we normally think of it. So the minimum distance between the Earth and Venus is 24 million miles. If you have a look at this, this is how we generally
very near, isn't it?
Of it. Yeah, well, it is in sort of space terms. The minimum distance to Mars is 34 million miles and to Mercury it's 48 million miles. So you would imagine that it all goes like that and everybody stays in the same lineup. However, that is not how orbits work. So let's have a look at this video, which explains it a little bit more. Initially, it looks as though Mercury is the furthest away, but the way the orbits function is that Venus often is right the other side of the Sun, making it really, really far away. And there's a guy called Oliver Hawkins, and he wrote some computer code to try and work this out. And he found that the planet that spends most of the time closer to Earth than any other is Mercury. So it's closest to Earth 46% of the time. Oh. Venus was closest 36% of the time, and Mars only 18% of
the time. I think I did say all of that.
Yeah. Anybody have a mnemonic to remember the planets in order?
Yes. It's Mercury, yep. Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune.
Thank you, darling, that's perfect. That is the order and...
Pluto doesn't count. It's actually a Disney character.
Yes, that's right. That is the order of the planets, and one is often taught it at school. So many volcanoes emit mulberry jam sandwiches under normal pressure. Or my very easy method just speeds up naming planets, so there were...
I couldn't get past vagina, though. I've got moist vagina expected, might just steam up 90.
So weirdly, that's probably the one I'm going to remember. Anybody else? Alice, you've got one?
Mine's quite depressing.
OK.
Mum's vacant expression means Jane sulks unless noticed.
Wow, you were a jolly girl at school. My favourite is Mary's virgin explanation made Joseph suspect upstairs neighbour. Worth pointing out, of course, that Pluto is no longer regarded as
no,
a planet.
Not there.
It's now a dwarf.
Nearly all the light in the world, of course, comes from our sun. In which month is the sun closest to the Earth?
Oh, God, it must be July.
No. Well, isn't it the same distance from the Earth all the time?
No, because it's an elliptical orbit.
January, February, March, April, May.
Yes, you're right, first time, January. Yes, people make the mistake that summer is somehow the time when the Earth is closest to the
well,
sun.
Well, look, that is summer, mate.
No, summer is not when the Earth is closest to the sun. It happens to be in January in the southern hemisphere that summer, but in the northern hemisphere, the sun is closer to us in January than it is in July. The tilt of the axis, when the maximum amount of sunlight is on and you have the longer days, that's what makes the seasons. Not the closeness of the sun to the Earth. What was interesting is, are the tropics. The first person to reason the tropics were not hotter because they're nearer the sun, but because a smaller area is lit by an equal amount of light compared to other latitudes was George Best. It was absolutely true. It was George Best who worked that out.
Oh, you've lost it now. You've completely lost it. You're going to have to hand this over to
someone
else.
It was George Best who was killed 2 years later in a duel in 1584.
Yeah.
But, he was an Elizabethan scientist.
George Best.
Just for a second, didn't you think that the Northern Irish hero might have worked?
Well, you come up with some interesting stuff when you drink that much.
You do. He might have come up with that. It's a nice thought.
You know what I reckon?
What quite interesting object is at the very end of the Earth?
Telford Town Centre. Although I would argue about the interesting bit.
At the bottom of Patagonia,
It's right down there, yes. It's the southern pole of inaccessibility.
Ooh, is it the off switch?
To stop it spinning.
Plug hole.
Well, I'll tell you what it is. It's most unusual. It's a bust.
There's a bust.
There's a bust.
Oh, worth going, then.
Yeah. In the sense not of a pair of breasts, but in the sense of a sort of head and shoulders and front bit of a human being.
No, we didn't really think there was a big pair of tits.
It's of a living 20th century person, now dead.
A man.
Yeah.
Stalin.
Oh, the one before.
Lenin.
Vladimir Ilyich Lenin is there, right in the middle.
It's just bizarre.
This southern pole of inaccessibility is more remote and hard to reach than the geographical South Pole. And in this very year, the destination was reached by a team of four Britons called Team N2I, Rory Sweet, Rupert Longston, Henry Cookson and Paul Landry. And we have one of this expedition in the audience.
Is it Lenin?
No. Mr. Rupert Longston is here. There he is, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. Isn't that bizarre? How far did you actually have to travel? Because there was no mechanical power, was it?
No mechanical power. We travelled 1,100 miles in total. Some of it was cross-country skiing and then kite skiing.
Was it cold?
When that picture was taken, I think it was minus 60 degrees Celsius.
What did you eat?
Fairly repetitive. It was chocolate, cheese, salami, pasta, lots of it. And one day towards the end, when we'd been eating the same thing for about 40 days, we played laxative roulette. And one person had laxatives in their food. We didn't know who.
Well, I bet you did.
Not straight away. The consequences were quite obvious after a while.
Does it freeze as it comes
out?
Oh! Does it offer a shard of shit? No!
When did the Russians put that there?
1958.
Good Lord. Rupert Longston, A, congratulations on doing an extraordinary first and being very, very foolhardy and very brave and very brilliant.
No, clearly not an extraordinary first. There was a statue there when they
arrived. They went under their own power. No one had ever done that before. Congratulations. Thank you very much, Rupert. Thank you. That's amazing.
I like the idea of that, though, the idea of going and doing that with no mechanical device whatsoever. Yeah. His moon mission's going to be amazing. Give me a man up a ladder going, oh, this is madness.
How many poles are there at the ends of the Earth?
Oh, now, obviously, now...
Well, that's
clearly
a dangerous...
Maybe there are four. There's the top of the Earth and then there's the magnetic... Well, is that what you're getting at?
Yes, it is. I'm getting how many North Poles and South Poles are there in
two
of
each.
Two of each.
So you're saying four?
I really, really tried hard.
You did try hard. You've got to use that, but take it further.
Eight.
Oh! Have another go.
No, I've blown all my elephant points now. Yeah. 16.
It's 11. I know it sounds bizarre, but I'll try and take you through them. They're the two geographic poles, as they're known, North and South Geographic Pole. That's where the Earth's axis of rotation meets the surface, as it were. So that's, you know, pretty obvious, you'd think. There's the Earth, and it's spinning round, you know. There's the...
I'm just saying... I'm just not sure whether that's the best mime you could have done.
Right.
There where geographical pole where this happens.
I was trying to be like, it's going round the...
Is that what happens when you get there, sir, is it?
Oh, well, look. OK. There are the two geographic poles.
Yes.
There's the geomagnetic poles.
What's
where the Earth's magnetic dipole meets the surface.
Obviously.
Yeah. There are magnetic poles where geomagnetic field lines point vertically into the ground in that way that electrical fields and magnetic fields do. Yes.
I want to go home now.
All right. You can't. We're going to get through these. Girls never like the physics. It's odd.
Please, I feel sick, sir.
Yeah. Even polar guy, who's kind of into this as a topic, dozed off at this stage.
There we are. There are 11 poles, two geographic north and south poles, two magnetic poles, two geomagnetic poles, two poles of inaccessibility, two celestial poles and one ceremonial south. How many moons does the Earth have?
Oh, God.
Yeah.
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 Most definitely only one.
Oh, dear.
Of course.
It had to be that.
Of course.
Yep.
Well, it is the moon. I think I'm with him.
Yeah.
They've changed.
They call it...
The one and only moon.
Well, the moon's around, clearly around
the
other planets.
The moon in June, all Jupiter them songs, has... come on, they're
there
all about the moon.
Lots of orbiting objects, aren't there? Some of them are really...
There are lots of orbiting objects, yeah. We gave an argument there were hundreds last time, to confuse you, but there's another argument which seems quite compelling and interesting, certainly, which is that there are none. Which is to say that the moon is not a moon. The moon actually qualifies...
Well, we've just discovered it's turquoise, and now it's not there.
It qualifies... it's there, but it maybe qualifies as a planet. A wanderer, a planet, because...
Well, the Klangers lived on it, didn't they? We know that. So, all that.
Well, in order to be a planet, the International Astronomical Union in 2006 laid down definitions. These were the ones that booted out Pluto, I think. So it has to orbit the sun.
Right.
It has to be massive enough for its own gravity to make it round. It has to have cleared its neighbourhood of smaller objects. The moon comfortably fulfils the first two. On the third, it makes more sense to say that the Earth and moon together have cleared their neighbourhood. The Earth certainly hasn't cleared the moon, so they are a binary system, like binary stars.
And... like lichen.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So there is a genuine possibility some people... And the sun's gravitational effect on the moon is more than twice that of the Earth's. So we don't have nearly as much gravitational effect. So there is a good reason to suspect that we are actually in possession of a fellow planet.
It goes round the Earth.
The Earth orbits the moon as well.
What?
Yeah.
Is it?
I know. He's an asteroid. So, we've been consistently inconsistent about this, but tonight we're saying that the Earth doesn't have a moon at all.
How much of the Earth is water? 2/3. Oh, wallaby, 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 wallaby. Is not the right answer.
I'm counting the whole planet as it is.
Ah, well, no, nothing, virtually.
Quite right. The answer is less than 1/50 of 1%. 7/10 of the Earth's surface is covered in water.
About 2/3.
Which is about 2/3, which is exactly right. But the Earth is big. It's very, 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 very big.
It's not that big compared to Jupiter.
No.
Or Saturn. I raise you, Jupiter. The Earth can go into the spot on Jupiter. Do you know what I think is a bad idea? Humans spreading onto other planets and into other galaxies. That'd be the bad idea. We should stop ourselves.
Why?
Because we're just bad.
What,
no, we are. As a species, we're bad. Don't start giving me Shakespeare's sonnets.
Well, you're giving
we're
me...
We're wicked.
Carl Sagan said a rather wonderful thing when they sent out one of those early Mariner probes or whatever, the one with a gold slab on it with digital information, as a binary information.
Voyager.
Voyager, that's the one. It had information about where the Earth was in relation to the solar system and so on. And someone suggested having some digitised music on a very early semiconductor sort of microchip. And someone said, well, what's good, have some Bach. And Carl Sagan said, I think that would just be showing off.
That left in when, the late 70s?
Yes.
That's only just got to the edge of our solar system.
But it had to get the special connecting bus service from Crewe. Yeah.
Right there. Absolutely.
Well, the Earth may be too small for Alan, but it's big enough for most of our purposes. It has a total mass of about 6 million billion billion kilograms. Even on the apparently watery crust, the mass of the land is 40 times greater than that of the ocean. What would happen if the Earth suddenly stopped spinning?
We'd all fly off it.
Oh!
Marcusy.
We'd all fall off.
We wouldn't fall off, no.
Oh, there'd be numerous consequences, Steve.
There would. Name a consequence.
Well, half of the world would be plunged into eternal darkness.
That's a very good point.
And they would all leave and come and join the light side. Or would some of them go to the dark side?
Ah.
It would change the very nature of human life on the planet. From the dark and the light people. What about the animals? All the ones who like the dark, they'd have to get to the dark side.
All the moths would have to go
over. The moths would have to go that way. The butterflies would have to go that way. The moles would be really confused. What about on daybreak, when they start broadcasting? Do they know when to start daybreak? The weather would be substantially changed.
I should imagine the weather would be enormously
floods,
changed.
Floods, big floods and...
The seas would come to an enormous...
Tsunami,
famine,
and earthquakes.
Pestilence.
Rain.
Yes, exactly. Moans will be heard over the face of the deep.
And your mobile wouldn't work.
If you'd only be able to grow food on half of the world.
The other half would have to come to the light side for food.
They could have mushrooms and rhubarb.
They would only be able to have fungi.
I'd live on that side. And what time would the four horsemen of the apocalypse turn up?
Yes, the sound of the last trumpet.
Do you think they'd book an appointment, the four horsemen? Yeah, well, we will be round. You'll have to be in between 8 and 7. He's at the lights.
Well, the point is the Earth spins at about 1,000 miles an hour at the equators. Slower at the poles, obviously. I remember my father explaining to me how the edges of a record were going faster than the bits in the middle. I said, that's not possible. How could that be? He said, well, how could it not be?
Yeah, you know? Like when you slam a door.
Yeah.
The end bit's going very, very fast.
Yeah.
The other bit that traps your finger on the inside.
Yeah.
Very slowly.
Absolutely right.
So
get
if
two
it
children,
stopped, would you...
but one there.
Less difference in the same time.
Would you fall over?
You'd certainly fall over. The point is, the Earth spins at about 1,000 miles an hour, as I say, at the equator. It would have to be almost 17 times more than that to defeat the effect of gravity. We would just scrape along the ground at 1,000 miles an hour. And we'd, you know, good to have shares in Savlon because we'd have...
All right, and if I scraped along the ground at 1,000 miles an hour, I'd kill a load of old ladies.
If aliens arrived on Earth to abduct our most successful inhabitant, where would they look?
Neverland. Are they aliens?
I think that's a popular
idea. How the hell did you get a shot of them? That an alien boy band?
It's Hubble boy band. Yeah.
Alien boy band. It's like alien YMCA.
They would look and see which was the most successful form of life.
Cockroaches.
On Earth.
Cockroaches.
Are you talking about the amount of awards?
Bacteria.
Bacteria is the right answer.
Bacteria.
By far. Any criterion by which you judge the success of life, bacterium win hands down in terms of profusion, diversity, ability to live under extraordinary conditions.
Yeah, but nobody likes them, do they?
Well, yeah. We wouldn't be alive without them. We entirely depend upon them. If chicken had no bacteria, it would be completely tasteless. It would not taste anything. Or that's true of almost all food.
Cheese, of course.
Bacteria. There's only a very small number of bacteria dangerous. If you were to take a gram of soil, there are 40,000 species of different bacteria in that 1 gram, let alone the amount there are. And each species is as different from each other as a rhinoceros is from a primrose. I mean, they're amazing things. I wanted to fall in love with the bacterium. They are just the most marvellous things conceivable.
Really, so me.
They live in boiling acid. They live in ice. They live in nuclear cooling water. I mean, they can live absolutely anywhere, under 6,000 atmospheres of pressure.
Where's their favourite place, though? Where do they really like to hang out?
Human tummy.
They live in
they love the human tummy. We reckon 75% of the bacteria in the tummy have not yet really been identified as separate species. They're fantastic. But they do exist all over the place.
What about pygmies, though? Surely pygmies are more hardy, aren't they? they can live anywhere in the
There's
world.
A lot more comedy in
pygmies
them.
Pygmies can live
bacteria. Oh, bloody hell, so warm up on the bacteria again.
So why do you say that pygmies are...
Well, because you say successful, you're imbuing them with some sort of human characteristics.
No, I'm not. No, I mean successful in purely Darwinian terms.
Ah, lots
of them.
Yeah.
Are they all invisible to the naked eye, or are there any kind of cat-sized...
No, they're all...
one as a pet, big, hairy bacteria.
No, they look it under microscopes, some of them, don't they? They have parthenogenic sex, as it were, amongst themselves,
what sort of
each
sex?
To the other. Virgin birth, you know? They divide and split and divide and...
Like amoebas.
Reproduce their DNA, which is...
Yeah. How many amoebas does it take? There's a light bulb. One, no, two, no, four, no, eight. I'm 100 million. Stop!
Very, 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 very good indeed.
Right, we start off with how many oceans are there on Earth?
Oh, no. 6, I can count them.
First time on the show.
Straight into that trap. Any
five,
more?
Five.
Oh.
What?
One is the correct answer.
Well, they're all joined, aren't they?
That is the reason, indeed. According to America's National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, there's only one ocean. It's the World Ocean. It covers 71% of the world's surface. So, to make it a bit more convenient, they divide it into 4 smaller oceans, the Pacific, the Atlantic, the Indian, and the Arctic. And the US Board on Geographic Names recognises the Southern, that's the Antarctic Ocean, as a 5th, but the International Hydrographic Organization has not yet approved it, and I imagine there's going to be a fight. Largest ocean in the solar system. Anybody?
In the solar system. Ooh.
Got to be reckoned.
Well, it's not going to be an ocean with water in it, is it?
Well, that is the thing that we do not know.
It's one of the moons. Is it the what?
Yes.
Eucalyptus.
What's it called?
Titan. Yes. It's bound to be Titan. That's
Euripides?
The
Euripides?
Europa.
Europa.
So I'm going to give you an extra point for that because, very good. Absolutely. It's Jupiter's moon, Europa. The Hubble telescope has detected a water plume which is 20 times higher than Mount Everest. So, possibly, there is three times as much water on Europa as there is in the world ocean.
If it's water.
If, well, it's hard to
say. We don't know what could be custard.
Famously, Jupiter custard.
If it's custard, where were the eggs sourced?
Are you worrying about the organic nature of Jupiter?
No, I wouldn't mind if it's sort of powdered custard, but either way, you've got to think, where's the vanilla come from, the eggs? Got to think about it scientifically. Well, because that's one of the things that means it probably isn't custard.
Yes.
That's why they've jumped to water. I'm examining it properly.
Mm. Please don't let this be caught by you, this system that David employs.
I like powdered custard.
How does this happen to me? McTurn, general ignorance. Fingers on buzzers, please. What is the most expensive liquid on Earth?
It's probably a wine.
Yeah, anybody else?
Elvis's bathwater. There's someone doing little vials of beetle.
No.
Yeah.
Really?
Go online, have a look.
And people are buying
little
it.
Little vials of bathwater.
Yeah, because when he died, everybody went, oh, I know, save the bathwater.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
I thought he died on the toilet.
Okay. Yeah, that's much cheaper, that water.
We think the answer is probably racehorse semen. There is an internet factoid that says scorpion venom is the most expensive liquid on Earth. It is £30 million pounds per gallon. But here's the thing about scientists. They've worked out a new way of breeding and milking scorpions. It's brought the price right down. Oh, yes.
Oh, they've ruined the market's crash.
I know. You can now get a gallon of scorpion venom for a mere £70,000.
Now, come on, Daisy, put your stinger in the milker.
A gallon is a lot.
It is a lot. You can get a gallon of LSD for £123,000.
It's on-off Waitrose.
Chanel number 5, £20,000 per gallon. Printer ink, £2,000 per gallon. We're heading down the prices
here. Holy shit, that is a racket, isn't it?
That is a racket. But the most expensive liquid that we can find seems to be racehorse semen. So, for a mare to be serviced by a famous thoroughbred called Galileo would cost the owner about £540,000. The average volume of a stallion's ejaculation is 65 mil. So, Galileo would have to ejaculate 70 times in order to produce 1 gallon of semen, and so his semen would be worth almost £50 million per gallon. It is the most expensive thing.
Wow!
I know!
How much is a man's semen worth?
Yours, a quid.
Yeah.
What, a gallon? In Poundland.
Horse semen is much more expensive than printer ink, but even if it was cheaper, it would probably cause some kind of paper jam. Now, what is traditional marmalade made from?
Quinces?
Oranges.